So can we start with today's session, ma'am?
Yeah, I'm ready.
So good afternoon all. Welcome to our 11th session. Today we will be having the continuation of gastrointestinal symptoms, bowel obstruction taken by Dr. Svandana Raya. So we can start with ma'am's presentation. We can have it for around 40 to 45 minutes, followed by 15 minutes of discussion. Around 4 o'clock, we can have our case presentation, followed by its discussion. We can wind up our session by 4:30. Thank you all for joining in. Over to Sunil sir.
Good afternoon. So today we are having one of the most important gastrointestinal symptoms, which is malignant bowel obstruction. We usually manage with many interventions like Weyl's tube and many things, but in advanced malignancy the management may differ, and so Dr. Svandana Raya will be handling this session. She is basically a pediatrician but has been in palliative care for many years, and she is working as a consultant in pain and palliative medicine at MNJ Cancer Institute, Hyderabad. Welcome, Svandana, and it's over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil. Hello, everyone. Thank you for the kind introduction. I just want to start by saying happy Pongal, if not happy holidays. I hope you're all having a slow day, a relaxed day, unlike our hub team, which is very busy organizing everything. And I hope you heard the word Murphy's Law, which is whatever can go wrong will go wrong. So yesterday my laptop crashed and I lost my presentation. But the presentation I'm using currently is Dr. Nandini Vallath's, and I would like to give the total credits of the presentation to her. Thank you, everyone. Let's go ahead with it. Malignant bowel obstruction. Even before I go into the slide, I just want to say that if we are not used to palliative care, when malignant bowel obstruction comes to our mind, there are two things that could cause it. One is mechanical bowel obstruction. The other is pseudo-obstruction. And in mechanical obstruction, as you all know, the most common cause is adhesions, usually post-operative. And then there is intussusception, there is volvulus, hernia, which can get strangulated and present as intestinal obstruction. And also the malignant bowel obstruction, which is also a mechanical bowel obstruction. So this is one category of it. And more than the cancer, I think we have learned so much about the rest of the causes. And going to pseudo-obstruction, this is where there is not exactly something that is obstructing the bowel, but the bowel is not moving as it should. So it could be because of myopathy or neuropathy. So the muscle is not moving well because of improper innervation. And the other one is Hirschsprung disease, where the distal part of the colon, the innervation of the nerves is not normal. So let's go into the pathophysiology of it. Next slide, please. Thank you. So if you look at it, the first thing, the topmost circle, which is obstruction or distension, this will cause secretions. So even before I go into all this, there are various mechanisms that are involved and which cause all these symptoms. If you look at it, whenever there is an obstruction, there is collection of food in the abdomen, and that's what causes the bacterial overgrowth, which are usually the normal commensals, but because of the obstruction and the food collection or the liquid collection, they grow very well. So that's on the top, the bottommost part on the right side of the slide, bacterial overgrowth. This bacterial overgrowth and their metabolism causes a lot of gas production, and this will cause distension of the intestines. And that is where the middle part comes, where there is obstruction to venous drainage. There is venous occlusion. So this will cause decreased oxygenation, which is hypoxia. And this hypoxia can either cause decreased peristalsis, which again is a common way we check for the signs of intestinal obstruction by auscultating the abdomen. And then it could also cause, due to the decreased oxygenation, the anaerobic bacteria kind of cross the bubble and enter into the circulation. That itself could cause sepsis, or even the toxins of these bacteria could enter into the circulation and that could cause sepsis. And then on the top, as you can see, there can be luminal hypertension and there can be damage to intestinal epithelium and inflammation. And on top of this, there is hyperemia, edema, and fluids. That is because of the inflammation and also because of excess secretion. There is a lot of collection of water into the intestines. And that itself could cause a loss of water and electrolytes, causing dehydration. And they can present as hypotension and in shock. And this hypotension and shock can again also be because of sepsis. So they can have septic shock and they can have hypovolemic shock. So it causes in all these ways the pathophysiology of it. Next slide, please. So if you look at it, it can be disease associated. It can be intraluminal or intramural. So these can act as a point of intussusception. And extramural is outside the intestine, and they could be infiltrating mesenteric or omental masses. And treatment associated, we have already spoken about the most common one, which is adhesions. And radiation, post-radiation therapy also, they can have strictures. And if they receive direct chemotherapy intraperitoneally, that could cause. And some drugs could cause bowel obstruction, like anticholinergics and opioids. And there are some comorbidities that could be associated with bowel obstruction, severe constipation, paraneoplastic syndromes, and intestinal tuberculosis and GI sepsis. Next slide. So one thing we all have to remember is it's most common in GI cancers and gynecological cancers. And it can also be seen in breast cancer, lung cancer, and malignant melanoma. And if you look at a palliative care unit, it could be seen in 15 patients out of 100. So next slide, please. So clinical presentation, one thing we all have to remember is the higher the obstruction, the symptoms are that severe, the signs are lesser. Whereas lower the obstruction, as in colon, the symptoms can be less severe and there are more signs. Next slide, please. So if you look at it, in proximal obstruction, which is, it could be gastric outlet obstruction and also small intestine, there are short intermittent cramps and they can have a lot of vomiting and it's usually watery or bilious and the distension of abdomen is not usually present and constipation may be present. Whereas in distal obstruction, which is usually in the colon, pain is a late symptom. And it is usually localized to the site. It is deep and visceral. And the cramps are very, there's a long gap between the cramps. And the vomiting is not as much, but when the vomitings do occur, they could be feculent. So it is very traumatic for the patients when they start vomiting fecal matter from their mouth. And usually they present with distension of abdomen. And constipation is present. And one thing we have to remember is even though it is intestinal obstruction, especially with colon obstruction, they can have diarrhea. Next slide, please. Coming to the plain X-ray, in proximal obstruction, as discussed, it's not very useful. But distal obstruction, as you can see, there are dilated bowel loops and air fluid levels. So it is also useful in ruling out constipation and which causes pseudo-obstruction. The sensitivity is less than 50%. So if, again, I think in palliative care, every symptom, we look at what is the goal of care of treatment for this patient. So if we are looking at a longer lifetime for the patient, I would go to all these investigations. But if I suspect that the patient is not going to do well and he has a very short time, I wouldn't go into all these investigations. Next slide, please. So bedside management, when we do We ask whether they're passing flatus or not. If they're not, it's called obstipation, and it could indicate complete bowel obstruction. Measuring abdominal girth could be helpful. It could be a good sign. And auscultation of abdomen for bowel sounds. If NG tube placement is part of the team's management, we can record output through it. And controlling pain and symptoms is very important, and maintaining optimal hydration. I would talk more about it. And electrolyte balance, as we have spoken, because of secretion into the intestines and also because of the vomitings, there can be severe electrolyte imbalance and also dehydration. And sepsis, which again we discussed in pathophysiology, which can be caused by the normal bacteria present in the bowel because they are entering the blood circulation or their toxins are. Managing sepsis sometimes becomes our primary mode of treatment. And it's also important to prognosticate in these patients. I think as a team, sometimes it's very difficult to decide alone. As a team, I think the doctors, nurses, and the other team members should discuss how long do we think this patient is going to live and what would be the appropriate course of treatment for the patient. Next slide, please. So some questions that we have to ask ourselves are, is it a true obstruction or is it a pseudo obstruction? And is the patient passing flatus? So is it partial or is it complete? Is it single site or is it multiple sites? Or is it subacute or chronic? Based on all these questions and the answers, our further management would be dependent. Next slide, please. So again, if we think the patient is going to live for a long time, we could go for CECT. Again, this will differentiate whether it's benign or malignant or true or pseudo obstruction. And also what is the obstruction and what is the level of it. And it also defines the area around obstruction. That is it because of lymphadenopathy or mental masses or adhesions? Next slide, please. So one thing we always have to remember, not just in palliative care, I think, in medicine in general, is communicating with the patient and the family as a whole about what is the point of treatment at this moment. So if we think from curative, the patient has advanced into, if this is the first time they're presenting with metastasis and it's an extensive metastasis, and if it is at multiple sites, so I would have the whole conversation about maybe we are shifting from curative to palliative, and that should be communicated. And empowering autonomy. There are times when the patient would refuse NG tube, and sometimes we respect it, and sometimes we give them time to think about it and then decide. Eliciting priorities. Some patients would say not at all vomiting would be their priority. Some patients would say wanting to be at home is their priority. Again, based on that, treatment would vary. And empathizing with them and providing emotional support, because just as a malignant bowel obstruction indicates increased morbidity and mortality to us, I think it represents almost the same to the family. So it's an indicator that the end is near. So I think discussing about that with the family and the patient is very important. Next slide, please. So coming back to this slide, if you can look at luminal hypertension, inflammation, and the next one, which is obstruction to venous drainage and hypoxia, and the next one, which is bacterial overgrowth. Next slide. So it's so for luminal hypertension, decompression would be the treatment of choice. NG tube or ventilation gastrostomy. Again, as I said, gastrostomy is a very invasive procedure. We again look at goals of care. Analgesics, there are two kinds of pain. One is the continuous pain, the other one is the cramping kind of pain. And based on the type of pain they have, we prescribe analgesics. One point I want to add about the analgesics are, we can give opioids, knowing that opioids would also decrease bowel decrease bowel movements, peristalsis. As symptomatic management, we can use opioids. And for pain, we also give steroids. And we can also use antispasmodic drugs here. And for acid suppression, we use anti-secretory. As discussed, there can be a lot of secretions, and to decrease the secretions, we use and to decrease the colicky pain, we use hyoscine, we use Rantac, and we also that is ranitidine. And as anti-secretory, we also use octreotides. The point over here about avoiding prokinetics is, if it is a complete bowel obstruction and we give a prokinetic like metoclopramide, that would increase the peristalsis, but there is an obstruction and that would cause pain. So by giving metoclopramide blindly to a nausea vomiting patient, if they have malignant bowel obstruction, might not be very helpful. But if it is a partial obstruction, metoclopramide can sometimes help in clearing the obstruction. It might be a little confusing. We can take this up in discussion because we do have time for that. And if there is sepsis, the treatment would be antibiotics. Next slide, please. So octreotide, as you all know, it's given usually as an infusion over 24 hours, and it inhibits substance B, decreases the secretions, it decreases the content in the lumen, and it decreases motility, and it also helps in decreasing splanchnic blood flow. So in all these ways, octreotide is helpful, but again, the cost of it would be something we have to take it under consideration. Next slide, please. Hyoscine butyl bromide, which is buscopan, it decreases gut kinetics, it decreases the secretion, and it also relaxes the smooth muscles. Again, as discussed prior, prescribing hyoscine and metoclopramide at the same time is counterintuitive and not recommended. Next slide, please. Dexamethasone, I think this is one drug that keeps coming up again and again in palliative care for pain, for nausea, vomiting, for bowel obstruction, for dyspnea. Again, the mechanism of action is anti-inflammatory, anti-edema, and it also has anti-emetic action. Metoclopramide is prescribed only in partial bowel obstruction and when there is no colic. It's a prokinetic, and if there is partial obstruction, it causes reversal of it. And metoclopramide is also an anti-emetic. Next slide, please. NG tube is temporarily useful, and again, as the picture shows, if the patient is not comfortable and you think this malignant bowel obstruction cannot be reversed, I would probably take out the NG tube again for the patient's comfort. Next slide. They can have various issues with it. It could be very uncomfortable for them. It can cause pain to them, sinusitis, pharyngitis. NG tubes increase the risk of aspiration, and it could cause erosion of nasal cartilage and any erosion of esophagus. And a lot of times these patients can't go out because of the NG tube. So that could cause social isolation. So because of all these reasons, we need to keep in mind one thing, the physical part of it, the other, the psychosocial aspect of it, and discuss with the patient. Next slide, please. So venting gastrostomy, again, if they have multiple levels of obstruction and if they have poor performance scale, they are not candidates for surgery. And life expectancy, if it's less than 1 month, we wouldn't put them through these. Next slide, please. Surgery, we can do debulking, resection, bypass. Again, it depends on the medical facility you have. If it's overworked surgical department, and if they would put the patient for weeks together to get them on the list of patients and it's not done immediately, the patient would be suffering. And it's beneficial if it's a single site, or the expected survival is more than six months and they do not have other issues. And one thing we do have to remember is there can be a recurrent obstruction, 10 to 50%, and 30-day mortality is 5 to 40%, which is not at all small. And post-op complications can be 9 to 90%. Next slide, please. So when do we not do them? Advanced malignancy, poor performance status. I don't think even the anesthesia would give agree for the surgery then. If it's a bulky intra-abdominal disease, and if it has spread outside abdominal cavity, if some other organ is involved, multiple sites of obstruction, and if it's a recurrent obstruction, if the patient is elderly, and if there is peritoneal carcinomatosis, all these are not, they're not contraindications, but I would say that operating a patient with any of these issues would only add to the problem they already have. Next slide, please. So there are some other things. I don't know how much all these would be useful, because we actually don't offer them, the first two, SEM, self-expanding metallic stents, and photocoagulation at our own center. Palliative radiotherapy, again, it can be useful if it's a single site, and it can help at decreasing edema and relieve bowel obstruction. Next slide, please. So one thing, if this patient ends up in the ICU or in a general ward also because they're not able to keep food down, TPN could be something that doctors are prescribing. Again, think if there is minimal tumor burden, if the patient has good function, good life expectancy, and if they're waiting for a definitive surgery, putting them on TPN is helpful. Otherwise, again, putting them on TPN could be decreasing their quality of life. Next slide, please. So I went through a bit fast. I just want to add that to increase gut motility, one other thing we can do is add metoclopramide. And for nausea, vomiting, haloperidol and promethazine can be considered. So I know there's a lot of time for discussion, and I'll over to you, Rajalakshmi and Dr. Sunil. Was it very fast? Is that why I finished it soon?
Yes,
I don't know. I thought I covered almost everything. So
I think we have a lot of time for discussion. So you can ask anything you want.
And Sunil does this topic excellently. Last time I have seen him answer some wonderful, wonderful questions. So I'm glad he's there too. So was it too fast for you people, or do you have any questions?
Dr. Narendra? Yes, sir.
You presented it very nicely regarding the surgical indications and non-indications. That was really appreciable. And for that single point obstruction, definitely we should go. And for that, it is better we go for ileostomy rather than this gastrostomy. Because we have done some cases where it's too much bulking which is required. We just immediately have done an ileostomy, and so that there will be no obstruction, because the ileostomy will have more space of the fluid and other things to grow. And regarding the octreotide, in our center we can't do, because octreotide is more than, but 10 mg, it is around 3,500 or so. So we will be draining all the resources with octreotide only. So that maybe I can't, the patient can't afford. And that is what my patient's level are. If a very rich boy guy comes, it's okay. But except that, then the rest of the thing presentation was very excellent regarding the surgical issue. And regarding the, if there are multiple obstructions, that point, that we can, once we open the abdomen, then we can immediately decide which part is viable and which part is not viable. And the thing about such anesthetic point, anesthesia people definitely won't agree for any such type of cases, because they are not sure whether we are going to come out or not. So they will never agree with us. So they are very ready and pleasing to give away the case, because this case is in a tertiary, almost like a palliative surgery it is. So, but then still we can do under spinal. That is not a big problem. Madam is there, senior anesthetist is there. Maybe she can give you light on whether they would prefer a terminally ill patients, whether they are ready to give anesthesia or not. That is not my part. But the other part, like keeping the rail shoe for so many days, is not advisable because it is very corrosive. And patient won't feel comfortable. Maximum, they will tolerate around 1 month. That is not mark, if at all, that is the highest that I have seen. Later, they will themselves pull it out. Because it is very flexible, that they will themselves pull out. And we have seen some patients with ileostomy and carrying with the oral therapy and morphine, oral morphine. They have very nicely maintained till 6 to 8 months. And passed off nicely in the sleep, rather than not in suffering. But the rest of the presentation is very nice. I really appreciate you, madam. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I just want to make a few observations on your comment. Thank you very much. One thing I just want to add is I agree about the octreotide part. It is quite costly even for our center, the center I work in. And if the patient can't afford, that would be something I wouldn't put them on. And regarding ileostomy and other stomas, I think that would be really, really helpful other than gastrostomy. One thing I am little doubtful about is if you are suspecting multiple bowel obstruction and if you think they do not have, if you don't think they have a good prognosis, if they have a limited time that they're going to be alive, I would probably not operate them. Again, but I'm a medical person, being surgical, I'm sure you would like to go ahead and try to help the patient. But one thing I would be thinking from the medical point of view is putting the patient through the whole issue. So that is one thing I'm thinking about. And NG tube, I agree it is corrosive. But again, maybe because I work in a cancer hospital, we see NG tube for 2-3 months in head and neck cancers. And those who have accepted it are doing quite well on it. So I'm a little hesitant about the 1 month timeline in NG tube because there are few patients who are comfortable with it. But as you said, I agree, it is not the most ideal situation. And Dr. Sunil, do you have anything to comment?
And Dr. Veena, I have a comment and I will make some comments after Dr. Veena's.
I had lost the video in between, that's why I asked. But the NG tube is always a problematic and dilemma statement for me because some people say in cases of where they're fasting and all that, you have to forcibly put the NG tube and you need not wait for the patient's autonomy. I would like to have some more clarifications regarding the indications for NG tube.
I got your question, but Dr. Veena, what was it about autonomy?
We have to ask the patient and we have to follow their, respect their idea regarding the NG tube. But in some of these cases, legally, is it right that we can put NG tube by force, even if they refuse? Is there any legal inhibition for us not to put, regarding the legal points and the patient's autonomy, is there any contradictions?
One thing I just want to add, even before legal, if I force someone and put an NG tube, the moment I turn my back towards them,
Doctor, your voice is breaking in between. Is there any problem with your internet connectivity there? Dr. Spandana?
Hello,
doctor.
Is it audible, ma'am? Sorry.
It is audible, ma'am, but it is breaking in between.
Frequently.
Dr. Sunil, can you take over? I'll just try to find an alternative and get back.
Okay.
Hello.
I don't know the Indian context as easily.
We have Dr. Anne Broderick here. She was the director of palliative medicine at Iowa University, US, and she will speak about her experience from her country.
So I can only speak from the context of the United States, but I usually give patients choices about a NG tube, whether they'll have an NG tube or not. I can't speak to the legal ramifications of that in India. It is the one situation where I have in a malignant bowel obstruction where there's copious amounts of vomiting. Many times the patients prefer an NG tube, which gives them control suction of their bowel contents over the constant vomiting. So many patients, even patients that I might be sending home, will prefer to have an NG tube with suction over in the US, over having the tube removed if I have not healed their obstruction, and if I don't think they're living long enough for a venting gastrostomy. If they're living long enough, I will always choose a venting gastrostomy so that they can have the pleasure of having something to drink, having certain, maybe even full liquids to drink, and have it just removed through the venting gastrostomy. That gives patients the pleasure of and less social isolation. So I'm not really contradicting anything that's been said. I just, this is one situation where I've seen patients prefer an NG tube to the copious amount of vomiting. I hope that answers your question, Dr. Lima.
I think if the patient doesn't want to have a treatment, even if that is life-saving, then I think we should go with the patient if the patient has the mental capacity to understand. But the problem arises when the interest of the caregivers or immediate family members differ. Then only the problem arises. Otherwise, we can go with the patient if he or she has the mental capacity. And I think some of the important points regarding malignant bowel obstruction, which we have to understand, is in advanced malignancy, actually patient can present, even a patient who has malignancy, the first presentation can be bowel obstruction in some patients. Those patients will not come to a palliative care person, but in patients who has advanced malignancy, many patients can present with intestinal obstruction, and ovarian cancer is the most common malignancy which causes intestinal obstruction, and as the disease progress, the incidence is also very high. It says about 5 to 5.5 to 42% is the incidence of bowel obstruction in advanced ovarian cancer. And the second most common is colorectal cancers. So if the patient has a very advanced malignancy, the important points are usually obstruction occurs at multiple sites. It is not at the single site commonly. So that is one thing which we have to understand. Multiple sites of obstruction occurs, and usually the obstruction is not only mechanical, there will be functional obstruction also. That means the nerve plexus which innervates the intestine is also infiltrated by the malignancy. So even if you remove one mechanical obstruction, that is not going to relieve the problem, because there will be functional obstruction. So these are two very important points that you have to keep in mind in case of advanced malignancy with the bowel obstruction. And regarding Ryle's tube, it is not a contraindication. And as Dr. Ann told, some patients would like to have a Ryle's tube. But usually what we do is Medical management is usually what is being done. So there will be many more secretions, and that is one of the cause for distension. And this distension is stimulus for more fluid secretion. So distension, secretion, it's a cycle. So if you reduce the distension, that is you remove the fluid, and if the patient has severe vomiting, then you can put a Ryle's tube and aspirate most of the fluid, maybe keep it for 1 or 2 days and remove, and then you give anti-secretory medications like ranitidine, which is a very good anti-secretory, and maybe other anti-secretory agents like hyoscine butylbromide or glycopyrrolate, which can also reduce the secretions. Medical management would reduce the secretion. If not, the Ryle's tube can be kept in some patients. And another problem would be many patients would like to take something orally, not through Ryle's tube, because all of us take food to enjoy it. So you have to take it orally, and then only the we can enjoy the food. So many patients would like to take it orally also. So we don't ask the patient not to take or nilpar oral, but you can for the first 1 or 2 days, maybe fluids can be given, and after that maybe soft food can be given. But you have to also communicate to the patient that there is a chance that you are going to vomit it out. By knowing this, you can take it also. So that's also important. And the somatostatin is something which can be used, but there was a randomized controlled trial with somatostatin over placebo to reduce the vomiting-free episodes. And it has been found that there was no vomiting-free days with somatostatin. And it has also found that those patients who are taking or those who got somatostatin, they had to take hyoscine butylbromide or glycopyrrolate to reduce the colic. So that's also another factor which we have to keep in mind. The cost of somatostatin is it's high, because about 100 microgram it costs about 500 rupees. So the proposed dose is a continuous infusion of somatostatin and logoglutide. So it will be costly, maybe about 3000 rupees per day. We can use other anti-secretory measures like ranitidine, hyoscine butylbromide, or glycopyrrolate if we want to reduce the secretions. Dr. Narendra?
Sir, can you unmute from your end and speak? Dr. Narendra?
Regarding the Ryle's tube issue, yes, we have to request the patients. We have to wait for the patient's choice only. We have no way to push in the Ryle's tube without their consent, because they are terminally ill. As far as the other emergencies it is concerned, we are not to consider their opinion. But in the end of stage diseases, where we know that the prognosis is very bad and is going down, patient is going down, let her be free of these pipes and tubes and needles. So that will be my choice of preference, because I don't want her to somebody to die on with a tube inside and the needles outside and a catheter inside. With all these things, look very cumbersome, and you can't even leave her to the house and let some nurse attend them also. And another thing is, in our setups, I'm not talking about advanced countries, in our setups, we can't provide a suction to the house also. So what we are going to do is, we are going to just give a 10 cc syringe and ask the attendant to pulling the system from the tube. That is only that we can offer them. But if the attendant is not there, she is going somewhere else, again she will have to vomit, and also with the rail sheave inside. That is very pathetic. So the thing is, when you cannot provide a positive suction apparatus to the home with the patient, I don't think so that we have any right to keep the rail sheave and ask her to go home. That is my opinion. Thank you.
Okay. Spandana?
Yeah, Dr. Sunil. Am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I'm thinking about what he said. I see that he feels very strongly about not troubling the patient, which is very, very good. But again, as we discussed, it is not the same for every patient. And we do offer them that. But if that is not on the cards and if they cannot handle it at home, I agree with you, Dr. Narendra, that we shouldn't put it on a patient who doesn't have a caregiver who would handle the patient and help the patient, and it would be definitely cumbersome. And one thing I just want to point out, which I probably haven't, when we say malignant bowel obstruction, usually the life expectancy is, they say it's ballpark around 1 to 9 months, which is not very good. So whenever we are talking about malignant bowel obstruction, especially in advanced malignancies, that is one thing we have to consider. And one thing I think we haven't touched upon is IV fluids. So either if it's intravenous or subcutaneous. Subcutaneous would be ideal for longer duration. And IV, I would say, would be helpful during emergencies. But then we do not want to put the patient on long-term fluids. These were my thoughts when I was just when I was listening to your discussion.
Another point which I would like to add is in intestinal obstruction, dexamethasone has some evidence that it can resolve intestinal obstruction. So the evidence says 16 milligram of dexamethasone once a day can be used to reduce or to resolve the bowel obstruction. So steroids can be used, and if it is, can you hear us? Those who can't hear us, please raise your hands.
Dr. Priya, is there any problem with your volume or phone?
No, my audio is all right. I have tried everything. I've gone off and on, rejoined.
Spandana, can you hear us clearly?
Yeah, I can hear everybody very, very clearly.
Dr. Priya, is there any headset with you? Can you use a headset?
Okay, I can.
Okay, so the bowel obstruction, the usual signs and symptoms of, or the classical clinical symptoms of bowel obstruction are constipation, nausea, vomiting, and colicky abdominal pain. And depending on the level of obstruction, there may be abdominal distension or no. So in case of bowel obstruction with mild colic or without colic, then you can use steroids along with the prokinetics like metoclopramide, which can also help to reduce the or overcome the bowel obstruction. And in that case, you can also use laxatives and enema also. But in case of severe colicky pain, then it would be it would not be good to use prokinetics, as it can increase the abdominal pain, and also if there is a complete obstruction, it is going to cause more problems for the patient. But dexamethasone can be used, and evidence says it has to be used in the range of 16 milligram.
Any more questions or comments regarding bowel obstruction?
Are there any more questions or comments? No. Okay. So I would like to summarize what we were talking. Bowel obstruction can occur in some malignancies, especially it's a feature of advanced malignancy. And if there is bowel obstruction, that patient has a poor prognosis. And ovarian malignancy is the commonest cause of malignant bowel obstruction, followed by colorectal cancers. The pathology of obstruction can be intramural or extramural, or even inside the muscle layers. This can be called as mechanical obstruction. Whereas in functional obstruction, there is no mechanical obstruction, but there will be problem with innervation or the nerves, mandric nerve plexus infiltration by tumor muscles or something like that. And sometimes diabetes, autonomic neuropathy, all those can contribute to, chemotherapy can contribute to functional bowel obstruction. The treatment of bowel obstruction depends on whether it is partial bowel obstruction or it is complete bowel obstruction. And even in partial obstruction, you have to divide it into, is there mild colic, is it a severe colic? And the treatment varies depending on that. Usually, with signs and symptoms, you will be able to understand whether this is a complete obstruction or partial obstruction. In complete obstruction, the patient will not pass the flatus also. The investigations can be maybe X-ray of the abdomen, and which can show multiple air fluid level in case of intestinal obstruction. And maybe hypokalemia, or things like that can contribute to bowel obstruction, functional bowel obstruction. In the treatment, if there is no colic, propionatic can be used. And in all types of bowel obstruction, steroids can be used to resolve the bowel obstruction. The advised dose is 16 milligram of dexamethasone. And anti-secretory agents can be used. The commonly used ones are glycopyrrolate or hyoscine butylbromide. Rantidine also. Rantidine is a good anti-secretory agent. Anything else to be added, Spandana?
I think you have covered everything very well. One thing, as you said, we should all be mindful of is the sepsis, and the patient could go into shock. So that is one thing we all should be watchful and mindful about. Yeah. Other than that, I think it's excellent. Thank you.
So we will move on to the patient story, which will be presented by Dr. Neeta. Dr. Neeta.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
Okay. I'm Dr. Neeta. I'm presenting a case of Pooni, age 74 years. She has been diagnosed with carcinoma scalp. Next slide, please. Her presenting complaints were she had swelling.
Dr. Neeta, can you speak a little more louder?
Okay. Her presenting complaints were she had swelling as well as pain in the scalp, and she had tiredness and weight loss. Patient had noticed swelling near the midline of the scalp, and she had consulted a local government and hospitals as well, but the swelling was persistent. Therefore, she underwent a biopsy and she was diagnosed with carcinoma scalp. She was further referred to RCC Trivandrum, and she underwent surgical removal of the swelling, and subsequent skin grafting was done. Skin grafting had to be done twice. She had also underwent chemotherapy. The patient stopped chemotherapy as she had vomiting. she had recurrence, so she underwent radiotherapy. But after that also, it was persistent, so she underwent radiotherapy again. One more radiotherapy session currently, just 2 months back. Now she is on regular follow-up from RCC, and she gets her wound dressing as well as medications from the palliative unit near her at her locality. Then she comes there weekly and gets dressing of her scalp. Currently there is persistent, the recurrence is still persisting, and she is also given medicines from the palliative unit free of cost. Next slide, please. On examination, patient is poorly built and nourished. Her blood pressure was 130/80. Pulse rate was 80. She had an ulcer, like a wound was there on the scalp. Next slide. She had underwent biopsy as well as surgical excision and skin grafting. She underwent chemotherapy as well as radiotherapy, and now she only wound dressing is done. The psychosocial aspects of this patient is that the patient is from a poor socioeconomic background, and she has only 2 daughters, and she has no other family or relatives to support her, and the whatever insurance coverage she gets from the government is not she's not able to meet all her treatment costs, travel costs, etc. with that. And she is actually getting free medicines from the local palliative unit, and she's very happy with the care of the doctors from the palliative unit as well as the RCC, and she completely trusts the treatment. She has no bystanders on the cases of admission in case of radiotherapy and chemotherapy and all. It was very difficult for her to meet the expenses associated, for the recurrence or surgery was considered, but the doctors had advised her that for her age it is risky, but she wants to go for the surgery because she says if something happens to her during the surgery also, it's okay, there is nothing to lose, and so she wants to undergo surgery rather than come every week and do it, because it's very difficult for her even to meet the travel expense. Excellent. Currently, the medication she is in hypertensive. She is on amlodipine. She is taking calcium, multivitamin, iron, then methylcobalamin, paracetamol for pain, and she is taking this norfloxacin. There was suspicion of an infection of the ulcer, so norfloxacin has been prescribed now. Next slide, please. The main concern I would say in this patient is that whether the chemotherapy have been continued would have been good for the patient or not, and whether she should go for a surgery again. Next slide, please. This is a 74-year-old female, known hypertensive, diagnosed with carcinoma scalp, underwent surgical excision, skin grafting, underwent chemotherapy and radiotherapy, but had persistent ulcer recurrence is there and now on regular follow-up. Discussion points. In this patient, it's an elderly patient with no family to support, people also of this age who has such diagnosis will be having difficulty having support, and financial strain will be greater for them, and the palliative medicine distribution and dressing at home of the patients will be more easier for them, and the importance of home-based palliative care.
So here we have a 74-year-old woman who has carcinoma of the scalp, who has underwent surgery, radiotherapy and chemotherapy, and she has a lot of financial and social issues. So what can be done for a patient like this? So, what can be done for this patient, for supporting her financially? Dr. Narendra?
Yes.
Dr. Murthy?
You have to choose and find out any possibility of a voluntary agency helping her, some food and other practice, and give that
drugs, palliative drugs, pain relieving drugs, and a small arrangement where can she can go dressings nearby. Maybe a PHC, maybe a auxiliary nurse, midwife, or dressing. Some trained assistant to give her dressings. Nothing else can be done for her. We'll have to arrange that some sort of voluntary agency could take her up and give support. Maybe some palliative care unit, if any, there in any of the nursing homes, they can as well take her. Nothing else can be done for her directly.
Dr. Bini.
I understand this patient is from Trivandrum because she's treated at RCC. I think of all the states, Kerala is the one which has the largest number of palliative care centers. They come to your home and deliver palliative care. I think if this doesn't happen for her, then nowhere else she can get better care than what is being given to her home-based. Thank you.
Dr. Nida, how is she getting? Is she getting palliative care frequently, or?
She's actually from Kollam. She's coming, traveling by bus, and coming to the palliative unit, and getting her medicines from there. And she also comes weekly to have the, otherwise the dressing she's doing from home itself, by herself. But for the inspection of the wound and all, she comes weekly here to the palliative unit and gets the wound inspection done and dressing done and gets the medicines from there.
Yeah, I think palliative care is available in Kollam also. So maybe I think one of the things which we can do is connect the patient with one of the palliative care units nearby their house, so that they can go frequently, if possible, to visit her. And regarding financial problems, I think, and the social problems, we have our senior social worker, Ashma, here. She will be telling us how to manage this.
Hi all. Now I need one clarification regarding the daughter's status, whether they are staying with the patient or...
No, they will be married off.
Is they staying near a Kollam or they are staying somewhere?
That I'm not that clear. She is in Kollam, in Paravur actually. The patient
stays alone in home.
Yes, that is what I understood.
So one of the thing we can do, we have to maintain some collateral contact with someone who is closely related to the patient.
Yes, okay.
Because it is their responsibility also. So as the patient is staying in home, it is not nice. So that is one thing. And the other thing is we can initiate some voluntary support, local volunteers.
Yes,
and we can maintain some that person can be a single point of contact for us.
Okay.
Also, that would be more easier for us to maintain communication and for the transportation to hospitals and all.
Yes,
then we can implement some we can facilitate some government benefits such as Biomitram, you know, Kerala right
okay.
now Kerala having Biomitram, and we can ask help from their part. Right now they are taking care of home-based palliative care as well as sometimes they will help to provide ambulance support for transportation also.
Nice.
The other thing, if possible. With the voluntary support, we can facilitate to get this government pensions, such as the patient is CA patient, so CA pension as having a pension, as well as the old age pension also become a help for her.
Okay.
Then the other thing, if we contact this patient is staying alone, we can contact Social Security Mission for more support. So right now they have one voluntary group called WeCare. Okay. A lot of NGOs, institutions, as well as other government volunteers also, they are in that group. So
okay.
They will consume their time for this patient. And that kind of support also we can ask for them. So I think these are the prior things we can do from our part as a psychosocial support.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Bombay is there in this group. Dr. Veena, do you do home care?
Dr. Veena? You were about to say something, ma'am.
In this case, I think the patient's counseling regarding her mental attitude may be better. She is depressed, I think. If only we talk to her and say this is, there is no, I don't know whether there is any evidence of metastasis which is not given in the history or examination. So if she makes up her mind, I think she will feel a little more better, because it's only the dressing, as I understand. And the traveling is her part. Finance is her problem.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Do you have home care, Dr. Veena or Dr. Bini?
Yes. Yes, we do go to home visits. 900 patients are registered, but it's a Herculean task to cover everybody, with the limited resources. Sometimes we may be able to see them only once in 6 weeks or so.
One of the questions was, what is the importance of home-based care? So what do you think about it?
Home-based care is very, very important because of this. They can't travel, they have no financial support and all that. I think home-based care is extremely important, as equally as important as the institutional care.
Yes. Okay.
Home-based care happens only when the family is willing to learn from us. So very often we visit and then we change the dressings and all that, but then they expect us to go every day and visit them, which is sometimes not possible. We would love to train the caregivers, but sometimes they insist that, you know, we have to come back again. So that is a problem.
Yeah, home-based care is something which is very important because of many reasons. As Dr. Veena told, many patients are financially not good enough to come to your OPD, or they don't have proper transport facilities, road conditions may be bad. So all these things, and even this patient's case, she has an ulcer on the scalp. And we don't know whether it is wall swelling or something like that. So if it is like that, the patients don't want that others to see there is a wound over the head, and if it is wall swelling, it will be difficult for others. All these things will be there in patient's mind. So it will be better to go and see her at her home, and we can also understand what are her living conditions. Maybe as per her living condition, we can advise what type of care should be given to her. We can advise her. Maybe there will be some people who would like to support her around her house, so that we can also take them into her care. there will be some people willing. And sometimes there will be volunteers so that they can also go and visit the patient so that her social isolation can be reduced. Even the dressing can be done by the volunteers or neighbors if they are willing to take care of the patient. And maybe we have to talk to the doctor, and sometime if the daughter is nearby, she can also come and join with her so that the patient will also feel comfortable. There is somebody is there for me to take care of me.
Yes. Yes,
and medicines, usually the palliative care team distributes medicines which are needed for the patient at the patient house itself. But I think the government palliative care system doesn't provide medications to the patient at the house. So they have to go to the primary health center and get the medication from the PHC. But if, as I told earlier, if there is any volunteer who can support this patient, it will be good for the patient.
Yes.
Are there any government pension schemes for such patients?
I told earlier, for cancer patients, they have cardinal pensions. Along with that, they will get, if they are above 60 years of age, means they will get old age pension also. But not any other pensions like a widow pension or some shamanity pensions, and that will not get together with the old age pension. Only one benefit will get from government.
Is it a state government or a central government pension? Is
the state government. Pension?
So in this patient, we have to get the help of government system as well as NGOs who is willing to help by maybe the financial assistance which is needed for the patient, transportation facilities, and even they can come and visit the patient to reduce the social isolation, and medications can be given at patient's home if there is a home-based palliative care team. So they can all look into the various aspects of suffering of the patient in all the domains like physical, psychological, social, financial, and spiritual aspects.
So, any more questions regarding the session or the patient story?
Vandana, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Do you want to add anything?
I think now would be a good time to introduce this patient to the local palliative care services when she is quite well. Sometimes when she worsens and she can't travel, that might be the time we would consider it, but the team will not have enough time to connect with the patient. So if you are trying to involve a different team, I think involving them when the patient is a bit stable and when they can have a good therapeutic relationship would be a good point, was what I was thinking. And I think there was one question about should we have insisted more on chemotherapy for this patient? My answer is I don't know, because I don't know what the patient wants. If the symptoms are very problematic, I would probably not insist. But again, palliative care is also supportive care. So during her nausea and vomitings because of chemotherapy, I would get involved and I would probably try to treat it with two or three drugs The usual one they try is ondansetron. I would probably also add metoclopramide, haloperidol, or olanzapine, or dexamethasone. I think I would try all the drugs and try to control. I mean, coming from a pediatrics point of view, probably, I would act as a supporting doctor there, and I would control the vomiting so my patient would be able to continue chemotherapy if it was what the patient wants. But again, at this age, based on her performance scale, if chemotherapy is not something she would be willing to go, then maybe no. Surgery, I think, because the patient has nothing to lose, she wants to get the surgery done. I think that would be very tricky because, again, there is no caregiver present. So yes. Post-op, who would take care of this patient and how would we manage her? I think that is very, very tricky. And keeping her on iron and folic acid tablets, I would be a little mindful of iron because it's not very well absorbed in elderly and it could cause gastritis. That itself could cause symptoms. So that was one thing I was thinking about. And yeah, these are my thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to add something more on intestinal obstruction. We are talking about steroids. Steroids act by reducing the peritumor edema, so that the lumen of the intestine, if you reduce the peritumor edema of something compressing, then the lumen can be more, the diameter can be more, so that bowel obstruction can be reduced. So that the colicky pain can also be reduced. And dexamethasone is a wide spectrum antiemetic also. So it has, it can reduce the pain, it can resolve intestinal obstruction, and it can also reduce the nausea and vomiting. Then if the patient has colicky pain, severe colics, then metoclopramide should not be used as an antiemetic agent. Haloperidol or ondansetron can be used. If the patient doesn't have a colicky pain, then metoclopramide can be used as a prokinetic as well as antiemetic agent. And antisecretory agents that can be used are ranitidine, isobutylbromide, glycopyrrolate, and somatostatin. Octreotide is not commonly used because that doesn't have much effect on intestinal obstruction. The evidence doesn't say much about octreotide. So instead, we can use isobutylbromide or glycopyrrolate. Then stimulant laxatives like bisacodyl can be given if the patient doesn't have colicky abdominal pain. But if there is colic, then we should not give stimulant laxatives for a day or two. So you will first administer dexamethasone, and maybe by the after 1 or 2 days, because of the reduction of peritumor edema, the patient's colic usually will be reduced. So at that time, you can add all the prokinetic agents or bisacodyl. And enema is one thing which you can always try. And in complete bowel obstruction also, dexamethasone can be used. You should not give prokinetic or stimulant laxatives, but enema can be used. And it is very important to select the route of administration of medication. It should not be given orally because the patient will have nausea and vomiting, and usually they vomit it out. So either intravenous or subcutaneous route is something which we have to select for administration of medication. And opioids like morphine, even though it reduces the peristalsis, it is not contraindicated in intestinal obstruction. So it can be given subcutaneously, and if we need to manage the patient on a long-term basis, subcutaneous route will be the better one compared to the intravenous route.
Any more doubts or comments regarding the session? Dr. Narendra. Sir, can you
Yes, sir. See, if at all, okay, in malignant obstruction, we are going to put a rail shoe. Then how are you going to give the painkiller? Through which route?
Usually we give through subcutaneous or intravenous route.
But that, then we expect the lifespan for around 1 month. And you want to send her?
No. We usually don't put patients on rail shoe for a long time. We usually put it for immediate decompression. That's what I told, maybe for the first 1 or 2 days. For immediate decompression, you can use, and following that, we will institute medical management, isentretinoin bromide or glycopyrrolate or arantidine. That can reduce the secretion, and usually we take out the rail shoe.
Glycopyrrolate is also only through intravenous route only, no, sir.
I didn't hear.
Glycopyrrolate also is intravenous route only, no, sir.
It can be given subcutaneously.
Okay, that too, for only 1 or 2 days, we can carry with that.
No, even if the patient goes home, they can maintain the subcutaneous route. Because it is easy for the patient's caregiver to administer subcutaneously, and you can keep the subcutaneous needle for up to 1 week, and maybe during home care, and even if you can teach the caregiver how to put a subcutaneous needle. It doesn't need professional help.
Regarding the patient,
pain also, you can give morphine reconstituted, or even you can administer parenterally if it is morphine.
Hello, sir.
Yes, Dr. Srividya.
Sir, can you hear me? Yes, sir.
Yes, yes.
Sir, good evening, sir. Sir, Rob, I just want to ask regarding TPN, sir. So if we are preferring an IV route, and instead of giving like IV fluids or an NG tube insertion, how better is an option of TPN, sir?
So I think Spandana had a slide on TPN. Spandana there? Spandana?
Yeah. Sorry, can you repeat the question?
So she's asking about total parenteral nutrition.
So, So TPN again is in a hospital setting, not in home care or a hospice setting. And also for patients whom we think there is a definite intervention in the pipeline, mostly surgical intervention. So before, I don't think this is for patients who are severely advanced malignancy or obstruction, but these are for patients for whom we expect the lifespan to be more than few months, so that they could tide over the crisis and get over the surgery, and only then it is given. Again, in our center, we hardly use.
Dr. Spandana?
I think she has given the answer.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you.
Any more doubts or comments? Yes.
Okay. We will close this session for today. So thank you, Dr. Spandana, for joining us, and thank you all for an interactive session.
So we are winding up our session for today. So we can meet you on next Wednesday with a topic on respiratory symptoms taken by Dr. Raja Meyer. I have shared the feedback link. Give it a minute, do it, and then only leave the meeting. Thank you all for joining in. See you next week.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Dr.